I invite you to stand for the entrance of the family. Thank you. You may be seated. Dear friends, we gather here today to celebrate the life and the faith of Harry Raymond Delong. And we have much to celebrate and to remember with gratitude because Harry lived a rich and a beautiful life. We also gather here together to pray for this family, to be with them as a community of faith. For we know that God has called each of us to be present for one another during times of laughter and dancing, during times of rejoicing, and during times of mourning, to comfort one another in those times of sorrow. So there will be many tears today, tears of laughter, which is very appropriate. It's April 1st, and I believe that Harry liked a good joke. The service is a celebration of his life, and there'll be many stories told. I have no idea how Ramona snuck into the service, almost, but for those in the family who saw the first version of the service program, it almost was a service in memory of Harry Ramona Delong. I think Harry would have had a good laugh. I'm told that Harry loved to sing in church, that he was a real strong member of our choir, especially in the days when it was back on King Street. And Harry was old school. He loved the old hymns, he loved the gospel songs, and he always believed it was important to wear a tie to church. I don't normally wear a tie, but I wore a tie for Harry. Now, I know not everyone wore a tie, but I'm told that when Harry would sing in the choir, he always kept them in his pockets, so that if there was anyone who happened to forget a tie, there was someone to provide them. So I imagine if any of you want a tie in honor of Harry, you can certainly borrow one of mine. But ties are not mandatory here. Today we celebrate Harry's life in good fun. We will laugh and we will remember the wonderful memories of games, of laughter, of songs, of good food and friendship. But laughter is also appropriate, so is tears, because tears of sadness are also a part of this story. Because we all have suffered real loss for one that we've experienced God's love through. And so today we gather as a community around Pauline and around this family in both sorrow and in joy, remembering the good times and experiencing together what it means to be a community in grief. Today we are with this family, Pauline, Val and Mike, Richard and Christine, Janice and Paul, Chris and Joan, Sylvia and Sam. And of course, all the grandchildren, 11 grandchildren, 8 grandchildren, Jean, and all of the family who are here today. Even though we are reeling from the finality of Harry's passing, we know that we have found victory, and Harry has found victory in our Lord. In the death and in the resurrection of Jesus, we as a community share a faith that the God who has given us the gift of life will not abandon us in the grave. Harry has experienced victory in death, a victory that is present and available to all of us here today. And so let us begin this service in a word of prayer as we draw comfort and strength from the presence of God, our Savior. Let's pray. Almighty God, creator of the heavens and the earth, you are the source of all wisdom, of all truth, and of life. You're the God of undimmed love, compassion, and grace. So Lord, we come to you now. We come to you in your presence, desiring to remember Harry Delong and seeking comfort, your comfort. For we know, Lord, that nothing can separate us from your love, not sorrow, not pain, not even death. You are a God of all consolation, of unending love and mercy. And so, Lord, we turn to you even in the darkness of death, for from you comes a dawn of new life. We thank you for your Son, who died for us, who conquered death, and in raising again, restored to us the gift of eternal life. Lord, may we grow, continue to grow in our faith. May we move forward as a people, as a community, eager to encounter your presence, even in this service, for you, our Redeemer, are present here through your Holy Spirit. And after our life on earth, Lord, we anticipate what it will mean to be reunited with our brothers and sisters in a place where all tears will be wiped away and all things will be made new. Lord, we give you thanks for Harry, for the ways that his life has touched each of ours, for the difference that he has made for each of us. We thank you for his kindness, for his integrity, for his wit, and for his love. We thank you for the assurance that Harry is now with you in perfect health and peace and the fullness of joy. God, we thank you that we can know that same joy, that your Spirit might even now reach out to us in the time of loss that we feel so keenly, and that we may be touched by your Spirit of peace. Lord, answer our weakness with your strength, our despair with your hope, our grief with your comfort. Hear our prayers and our needs today. For in confidence in Christ Jesus we pray, amen. As we begin the service, I invite you to stand as we will be singing together, Hiding in Thee.
My soul in its heart, faith and song.
It's appropriate on a day like today for us to tell stories, for us to remember together. At the end of the service, there'll be a reception, an opportunity for us to move about and to greet one another and to greet the family, and I hope it's an opportunity that you will take to share stories and memories of the way that Harry touched your life. In the next few moments, we're going to be hearing many stories as we have tributes coming from grandchildren, from each of his children's families, and then a eulogy from some of the family members. I won't be introducing them. I'll let them come and introduce themselves as we pay tribute to Harry Delong.
Hello, everyone. They told me you weren't going to respond back, so I'm glad that you did. My name is Martine, and this is Jasmine. We really hit the jackpot with our Grampy and Nana as our grandparents. Many laughs were shared at every visit, often started by Grampy making Nana giggle, which is the most infectious giggle, and he knew it. Our Grampy loved our Nana, and we loved being around them, soaking up the love and joy they had to share. Our Nana and Grampy were quick to break into song, often duets they sang at events years ago as if they were yesterday. We were so fortunate to have spent many summers at our Nana and Grampy's cottage on Trout Lake. In honor of his memory, we will share a short poem he enjoyed and kept close. We hope you can feel the essence of Trout Lake in this poem like we do.
The sanctity of the forest, where I can reach out and touch the face of God, where I can listen to heavenly choirs of birds and babbling brooks laughingly cascading over warm, friendly rocks, where I can lie on my back in soft, green, cool moss and watch the clouds wheel and drift across an intensely blue sky, where the sun makes a million diamonds on the surface of a gently rippling lake, where warm raindrops cavort on the cabin roof and lull me to sleep. And I know that here's where I truly belong.
Hello, I'm Andrea, and about 20 years ago, I had my grandmother and grandfather fill out books about their childhood and memories, and about becoming parents and basically their whole life. So I thought I'd just share some of my grandfather's memories with everybody. A funny story about us. So these are his words, not mine. A funny story about us. Haircuts were usually done at home, and once when I was about 8 years old, my older brother Ottis was giving me a haircut, and he pretended to slip and cut about a 2-inch path from the back of my head to the front of the top. I was completely, and then I had to be completely shaved. I was so embarrassed, I had to wear a cap for over a week. My favorite memory from home. In the 1930s, before TV and even radio, we would sit around the kitchen and we would pretend that we were actors on a stage while the adults watched and would applaud. A practical joke that I played. I think he did this to you, Jean, so. I covered myself with a large black bear skin robe and I crawled into my sister's bedrooms after they were in bed. They really screamed. When I got my driver's license, in the spring of 1946, when I was 16 years old, the driver test was made by Randall Mosher in New Germany, Nova Scotia. He told me, if you can pass that old lady up ahead there, without hitting her, I'll pass you. I passed. What my father taught me, to be tolerant of others and always be ready to understand the other's point of view. Lessons I learned from my mother. Patience and willingness to offer help to anyone in need. One of my most memorable family reunions was in August 9th, 1997, when some 78 members met in a community hall in Barr's Corner, Nova Scotia. Present were three brothers, two sisters, plus spouses, children, and grandchildren. A great day. My greatest strength is the love of my wife and my faith in God. One of his favorite scriptures, he said, is Psalm 25:4-5. Show me your ways, O Lord, teach me your paths, lead me in your truth, and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. On you I wait all the day. One thing I love to do, sing. In the choir or male quartet. The thing I love best about your grandmother, her sense of humor and her musical attributes. I always wanted to be an active part of my community life and be involved where I could contribute to the help of the less fortunate. And then here's some things that are more kind of advice and just thoughts of his. Being a friend means caring and being available for each other. The dearest people on earth are those who care for and about others. I think real success means being content with what you have. My advice about work, if you don't enjoy it, don't do it. But if you enjoy it, then work really hard at it. Major milestones in my life include to see my 5 children happily married, to achieve a happy and loving relationship with my wife, and to have achieved a status of seniority and respect in my company. What I love about being a father, helping my children grow in all aspects of their life. What I wish for our family, continued good health and much happiness. That which I value most in life is that my immediate family and our faith in God. An important lesson that I hope all of my children and grandchildren learn is the importance of various points of view and to base decisions on biblical teachings. My goals today is to live a life of example for my children and my grandchildren. And then just a little favorite verse or poem about life. He said, through this toilsome world, alas, once and only once I pass. If a kindness I may show, if a good deed I may throw to a suffering fellow man, let me do it while I can. No delay, for it is plain, I shall not pass this way again.
I'm Stuart, and this is my sister Allison, and we're going to read a passage from the Sermon on the Mount. Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said,
blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted.
Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled.
Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God.
Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. We're both very grateful for the faith that our grandfather passed down and modeled to us throughout his life.
Hi everyone, my name is Jocelyn, that's my sister Rebecca. We have a couple memories we're going to share in just a moment. So talk amongst yourselves. No. Do you want me to start with one of mine? Okay. So when I think of Grampy, it makes me remember of how he would play jokes, and he would pretend that he got your nose with his, you know, half thumb. And he, Grampy just had the greatest sense of humor, and he loved to laugh.
Just needed a minute.
Okay. When I think of Grampy, I remember his woodworking, right? All of our childhood beds, built by Grampy. Our study desks when we were in school, built by Grampy. A storage locker for myself for my horse gear, built by Grampy. He was such a talented woodworker, and he loved to build many things, including furniture.
I remember how he would take us out in his four-wheeler at the house in Springfield. Sometimes a few of us grandkids would all be crammed in together in a wooden box on the back, piled on top, and some maybe on his lap in the front. We would weave through a field of Christmas trees and along winding paths in the forest, and we laughed and just had a good time.
When I think of Grampy, it makes me remember enjoying family time at the Delong cottage. As the family grew, Grampy had to build extra space for all of us, including a bunkhouse, more Adirondack chairs, more decks. From canoeing to card games, we had so many fond memories with the family at Trout Lake. And every visit feels warm and full of love, knowing that it was his hands that built the floor that we stand on and the roof over our head.
We have so many wonderful memories of our Grampy. And when we look at our family members, we are reminded of all the things that we learned and that we inherited from him. He passed on his faithfulness, his work ethic, singing voice, sense of humor, his card game skills, his love for the outdoors, and his love for family.
And when we were thinking about what we wanted to share today to honor Grampy, it made us also think of our dad, Richard. They were cut from the same cloth. Many of the qualities that we love in Grampy, we also loved in our dad. And we know that when Grampy was ready, that dad was there to greet him in heaven.
Hello. I am Benjamin Delong, the first grandson. So I got a little spot on the, got a photo at the front there, which I feel good about. But so I have a very short story and a verse that I was going to read. I was planning to become a pastor maybe a decade ago, and nobody helped me to work towards that as much as Grampy did. He made calls to Acadia Divinity, and he would call me, and he arranged to have me preach at his and Nanny's church in Springfield. And this was a verse that I chose for that sermon because the sentiment is something that I felt for my grandfather and Nanny. So I'm going to read Philippians 1, verse 3. So the sentiment was this. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. So that's what I chose back then because it's what I thought of when I thought of my grandfather and my nanny, and I think it's true again today. I thank my God every time I remember you.
Thank you.
Those are tough acts to follow. I'm Chris Delong. I'm the fourth child and second son of Harry and Pauline. I'm proud to say that. I know that my father would be very happy to see all of you here today, so thank you all for coming. He loved people. I wrote some things that I'm going to try to get through and say, some of my memories of him and some stories of him and just the way I felt about him. So I'll start. My dad was the best salesman I ever met. He must have been to be able to convince my mother to marry him. Dad was also a great public speaker, and leading with a joke would be appropriate, but it was no joke that he loved and was very good at sales. He wasn't a manipulative or deceptive type of salesman, no. He told the truth, and his real pleasure in sales was being able to help people. He honestly enjoyed getting to know people. He once told me that he always tried to get to know at least one person at every sales call. Eventually, he had friends in every city, town, and township in the Maritimes, and not just acquaintances, but real friends that he could drop by at their home around supper time and stay for a meal like he was family, and this is absolutely true. Dad was a proud father. He loved us all. He knew firsthand what it was like to come from a large family, coming from a family of nine, so he put effort into the little things that made us kids feel unique and loved. He made sure to lead by example in a Christ-filled home and made sure that we attended Christian church wherever we lived. He used to crank up the radio on Sunday mornings with old gospel songs to wake up the whole household to be ready to go to church as a family. Often he would join in and sing along, and he was always in tune. Dad was busy. He loved building things. He was great with wood. He created impressive woodwork, both for himself and for others. He loved music. He played trumpet and harmonica very well. He was even part of a barbershop quartet at one time, taking on the tenor role. I can remember trying to stay awake and listen to them sing when they practiced downstairs, filling the house with great four-part harmonies that seemed to carry on through the night and into the next morning. Harmonies. Getting along with people. That was his ambition in life. As Christ taught us to love the Lord and to do unto others as ourselves, Dad knew this was true and that he would get out of life what he put into it. Dad was a lover of the outdoors, as was already mentioned. Canoeing, four-wheeling, snowmobiling, hiking, or even just sitting and looking out a window and looking at it, he loved the great outdoors. I don't remember him ever complaining about one season over another or one being a favorite of his. He found satisfaction in all seasons. I remember him marveling at damage that was done by a hurricane one time, saying, "Look at what God can do." Not in shock or horror, but in amazement at the wonder of the power of God through nature. He loved it all. Dad was compassionate, and a favorite memory of mine occurred when we lived in Fredericton, and I was about 3 years old. I was hospitalized over the Christmas season. I was told that it wasn't actually Christmas Eve, but it was Christmas season that year, and I was very alone in my room, and I felt very alone. In those days, there were stricter visitation times, and Dad was busy managing the local branch of the company he worked with, so he was not able to visit when he was allowed to visit. Late one night, I heard something hitting the window by my bed. It was my dad. He was outside throwing snowballs to get my attention and show me that he loved me, despite not being able to come and see me. His big, broad smile is still clear in my mind of that night. I had the joy of being able to travel with my dad to Atlanta, Georgia on two occasions to help sell Christmas trees on behalf of my Uncle Otis, his brother. It was a daunting, month-long task, but I loved it. I got to see my dad in action, doing what he loved to do. One morning, a man came begging for work with my dad, and my dad saw an opportunity to help him. He let him help in processing and assisting people make their choice of tree and cutting the ends and carrying it to their car and wishing them well for the season. The man helped just the one day, but my dad paid him cash for 2 days, as well as fed him lunch and fed him supper with us like he was part of the family. I don't know whatever became of that man, but it taught me a great lesson in compassion. Money comes and goes, but our actions or our inactions can make lasting differences. Choose to do good. Dad was generous and understanding and all the good things that everyone should have in a father. Half of me is him, but I don't know if I could ever live up to be half of the man that he was in my eyes. I don't know if he can see me or hear me right now, but Dad, I love you. And I can't wait to see you again, healthy and happy, in our Father's arms.
Good afternoon. Thank you for all coming to honor Harry's life. My name is Paul Rand, and I had the privilege of being Harry's son-in-law for the last 40 years. I'll be speaking today about our family's memories of Harry. When I think of Harry's life, several versions of him come to mind. The first is Harry the musician. He tells the story that he made his first real money when he was 5 years old. That year, the top prize of the community talent contest in New Germany was 50 cents, and when a two-foot-tall Harry Delong sprang from a wooden carton painted like a jack-in-the-box and blew the final notes of Pop Goes the Weasel, the crowd erupted, and the 50-cent prize was his. Chris has already spoken about the fact that Harry's love of music never left him and that he sang in many choirs. He and Pauline also sang a lot of duets, including at weddings. And those of you who know him won't be surprised to hear that Harry's love of being well-organized extended to his music. But his filing of that music wasn't always flawless. One night he showed Janice and me a file folder of wedding songs. When Janice flipped through it quickly, she stopped, laughed out loud, and said, "Ooh, Dad, I bet you never sang this at a wedding. It's I'd Rather Have Jesus." Then there's Harry, the community leader. You know, pretty near everywhere that Harry lived, he was a leader. He was a president of the young people's group and popular song leader at West End Baptist Church in Halifax, Sunday school superintendent at Birch Cove Baptist, treasurer at Springfield Baptist Church. He was a municipal counselor and later chosen by his peers to be the warden for Annapolis County. He was an election campaign worker for that party whose main color is blue. And a member of the Kiwanis clubs here in Lunenburg County, where he helped Meals and Wheels and put the in-touch emergency contact system in place. In short, he was a man who stepped up when he saw a need. What place doesn't need a man like that? I also think of Harry, the durable friend. In a world where things change so fast, I suspect we'd all be better off if we fostered sturdy, enduring friendships like the one Harry built over his lifetime. Friendship with men like Reg Harris and Warren Lance, Jack Palmer, Doug Armstrong, Donnie Noss, and Bill Nogler, to name a few. Some of these were people he met through church or work. One was a neighbor at the cottage. Another was a man he met while hunting with me in Guysborough County. I can still see Harry and Bill Nogler spending frosty November morning sitting by the wood stove in the hunting camp, wearing the same clothes for 5 days straight, retelling the old stories, occasionally improving on them, playing cribbage and Bic, eating licorice, gummy candies, and that extra thick bacon that their wives swore would kill them, and counting it all as a highlight of the year. Harry made a point of staying in contact with these men over many years, sometimes seeking their advice, other times bringing them new stories and just catching up. It's clear to me that he understood that these deep, long-term friendships enriched his life. And younger men, like this one, watched and learned. I suspect these men also respected Harry because they saw in him someone who was Harry, the helper of those in need. Shortly after he was elected to municipal council, a man from the neighborhood arrived at his door carrying a sack of dubious origin and a rather pungent aroma. He stated he had come for the porcupine bounty and proudly announced that he had 20 porcupine snouts in his bag. Apparently, the municipality of Annapolis had a long-standing bounty and paid 50 cents for each nuisance porcupine killed, and it was not necessary to present the entire carcass to qualify for payment. Only the snout was required. Harry's response to this man says a lot. You see, the truth was that the municipality had dropped that bounty years before Harry was elected. Harry chose not to mention that detail. To his credit, he didn't see the man as someone looking for a handout on an expired government program. He recognized a person with a limited income trying to put food on the table. He followed his conscience, calculated the value of the bounty, and paid the man without hesitation. Over time, that man appeared on a regular basis with more of these prizes. And each time, Harry would wish him well and pay him cash on the spot. As I think of this story, it reminds me of a line in a well-loved hymn called "They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love." You probably know this one. And the favorite line in that goes like this: "We'll work with each other, we will work side by side, and we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride. They'll know we are Christians by our love." So, if we find ourselves wondering what it might look like to guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride, it might look like Harry Delong buying porcupine snouts. Harry, the faithful husband. You know, Harry and Pauline met at Young People's Group at West End Baptist Church in Halifax. And how could Pauline possibly resist the boy who led the singing and proudly showed off his chest hair? They were married for 70 years, had 5 children, 11 grandchildren, 9 great-grandchildren. And through all this, he made sure that he told Pauline every night that he loved her. Then there's Harry the father. Harry the father. To say that my wife Janice is a lot like her father is like saying that Harry liked a spoonful of ice cream occasionally. Both would be a large understatement, an understatement the size of the Grand Canyon. On Janice's Facebook page appears a simple sentence about her relationship with her father. She wrote these words: "He gave me a love for God, the outdoors, and adventure." Now, there are three gifts that stand the test of time. They help explain Janice's own faith and that instinctive desire to explore those woods, paddle that river, climb that ridge, roam that beach, share those experiences with others. Preferably all in the same day. How much better would this world be if every son or daughter could say something like that about their own father? One of my first experiences with Janice's father happened on the evening of the summer that I turned 18. Janice and I had been on a few dates together by this time. I was already infatuated, and Janice invited me to have supper with her family. I was acutely aware of my potential to say or do something stupid that would make a very poor impression, and somehow I managed to avoid any major landmines during the meal. I don't recall much more about the evening other than this. And that is that as I reached the door and thanked Janice's parents the way that I'd been taught to, Harry looked at me and said evenly, "There is something you can do for me." And I froze. And of course, anyone with a single functioning brain cell knows there's only one good answer to that question. And so I blurted out, "Of course, what's that?" Then Harry smiled, looked me in the eye and said, "You can come back real soon." That was 45 years ago, and I can still remember how that made me feel. Welcomed. Allison and Stuart say that when they think about their grandfather, they think of fun at the cottage, learning card games like Scat and Bic, the smile on his face whenever he'd see them, His tearful, his playful teasing and weird dancing, bouncy four-wheeler rides, handmade toys, games, and projects from the workshop, and as Allison points out, the reverent, resonant, and almost melodic tone of his voice as he prayed over family meals and gatherings. Jeff, I'll get you to put that photo up if you don't mind. Someone once said, a picture's worth a thousand words, and so as you look at this picture, I think you'll agree that the expression on Stuart's face, he's the one on the left, the expression on Stuart's face tells you everything you know how about his feelings for his grandfather. On this note, Harry liked to tell the story about visiting us in Cape Breton when Stuart and Allison were very young. When he and Pauline walked through the door, an awaiting Stuart seemed ready to explode in excitement. He squirmed and hopped from one foot to the other. His eyes bounced from Harry and then back to Pauline, and in the adrenaline of the moment, the only words he could manage to blurt out were, "You came! You came!" For years afterward, whenever Stuart and Allison came to visit, Harry would hold out his arms and declared, "You came! You came!" Harry the determined. No description of Harry's life would be complete without mentioning just how determined he could be to get something done. For example, it was 8 a.m. one spring morning in 1995, and I was working on our hunting camp back in the Ogden Lake Wilderness Protected Area. I thought I could see somebody walking through the woods with a load on his shoulder. And of course, it was Harry. Who else? He had built a cabinet for the camp, and he'd left Springfield, get this, at 3 in the morning, drove 4.5 hours to Guysborough County, unloaded his four-wheeler, drove 5 or 6 kilometers on very rugged woods roads, then hiked another 0.5 kilometer with a plywood cabinet on his back so he could arrive in time to meet us for breakfast. Madness. Harry the Pathmaker. Now, Harry and I hunted deer together for quite a few years, first in the woods around their house in Springfield and later at a hunting camp in Guysborough County. I soon learned that if you traveled the woods after Harry had been there, you could count on finding some marks that he'd left behind. He used his hatchet to blaze the face of the trees. He'd erect a pile of rocks. He'd stick empty shotgun shells on tree branches. He'd hang up a rusty pot or a tin can that he discovered near an old fire. The man never met a woods trail that couldn't be improved with a mark or two. Those of us gathered here, it's also plain to see that he's left plenty of other marks. Marks like a swath of children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren who bear the imprint of his character, a long list of enduring friendships and lives changed and made better because of his service. To close, of Harry's life on earth, it could truly be said he was faithful to God, he deeply loved his wife and family, and he gave generously of himself to others. And of his appearance in the life that follows this one, I believe we can be sure of two things, and we can safely guess the third. The first thing we can be sure of is that Harry will finally meet his Savior face to face, and he will hear him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." The second thing is, we can be sure of, as Harry looks around, he'll see in every direction the faces of excited families and friends who are thrilled by his arrival, and they will extend their arms and cry out together those familiar words, "You came! You came!" And in that crowd, he's going to find Richard. He's going to embrace him with a rib-cracking bear hug and whisper into Richard's ears those words we know are on Harry's mind. "Where do they keep the ice cream around here?" "How we loved you, Harry. Godspeed."
Good afternoon. My name is Sam Alley. I'm one of Harry's son-in-laws and Sylvia's spouse. I have some heartfelt words that Sylvia would like to share about her dad. But before I share those words, I'd like to share one of my memories of Harry and Pauline. Years ago, Sylvia and I invited Harry and Pauline down to our place to have some Kentucky Fried Chicken. We set the table with a plate and fork for each of us. The fork, I assumed, would be used for the salads that came with the meal. As we sat down to enjoy the meal, or this greasy little treat, Harry, with his little cute smile, asked for a knife. As a Kentucky Fried Chicken connoisseur, I looked at him and asked, "Why do you need a knife?" He politely says he needs it for the chicken. So I remember looking at Sylvia, then at Pauline, who was obviously on the same page as Harry, as, "Where's the knife?" I paused for a second, and then I looked at the big bucket of chicken, which read, in big red letters, "Finger licking good." At the time, I was a bit stunned. Growing up in small town Nova Scotia, there are some things you just do not do. So I looked at Harry and kindly asked, "Did you read the bucket?" I pointed to the tagline, "Finger licking good." I said, "Harry, you cannot eat this chicken with a fork and knife. It's just not done that way." He laughed with his big laugh, and he agreed to try the chicken my way, greasy hands and all. But I am pretty sure he was happy that I didn't deny the napkins. I never asked either Harry or Pauline since then how they ate their Kentucky Fried Chicken. I know this is a silly story, but it reminds me of the ever respectful, polite person Harry was. He kept firm values while leaning into the silliness of life. I will miss him. I am sure everyone can agree or relate to some or even most of the stories and comments that have been shared here today. Harry Raymond Delong was a great man. Here are some words from my wife, Sylvia. He had a strong faith in God and in people. My dad had a superpower to create a sense of self-confidence in others. He could pull the best out of you with that gentle little head nod and smile, or that not so gentle squeeze of the elbow. "You're doing a good job," he would say. I've heard him say this to so many people over the years. His kindness makes me so proud to have known it. He could cause you to feel that you were the only person in the room and that you were capable of anything. I admire our dad's devotion to his relationship and partnership with our mom. 70 plus years together and always affectionate. Partnerships require intention, devotion, and hard work. Mom truly was our dad's North Star. He signed his notes to her, YEAH, "Your ever affectionate Harry." Through their example, I've learned the value of taking the time to love one another. Take the time to love. Thank you.
I want to thank the family so much for being so generous and open with your stories. And for all of us to be able to be with you today as we remember Harry is a real honor. We're going to stand at this time, and together we're going to sing another hymn chosen by Pauline as she was thinking about those songs that meant so much to her and to Harry together. Let's stand together now, "Onto the Hills."
Oh, Our scripture reading comes from Psalm 139, verses 1 through 18. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all of my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in, behind, and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Memento qui sis. Memento qui sis. In 1853, 14 years before the Dominion of Canada was formed in 1867, Canadian grammar schools had four compulsory subjects. Can you guess what they were? English, math, arithmetic, Latin, and history. Those are the four subjects. Even post-Confederation, Latin continued to be taught in schools, right to around the 1960s when it started to fall out of fashion. By 2010, there was only about 60 public schools in Canada still teaching Latin. But of course, we still have Latin all around us. Our schools, our colleges, our universities, our towns have Latin mottos. And Latin is in our conversations. There's Latin words that we pick up because English is one of those languages that's always grabbing, aren't we? Magna cum laude, with great praise. Magnus opus, magnum opus, one's great work or one's masterpiece. Carpe diem, all those fans of Dead Poets Society knows it means seize the day. And of course, we ad lib, we have something that's bona fide, etc., etc. Oh, I'm glad you got that joke. Woo. But more than words, there are things that are old school values that have continued in our society and that little boys like little Harry Delong at the Centerville School picked up. He picked them up through his school, through his teachers, through his family, through his church. Memento qui sis, remember who you are. Harry was old school. Now, Western civilization has lots of skeletons in our closet. Our Western civilization has a lot that we can look back on our colonial past and we think, oh, those things might break God's heart. They do. There's a lot of darkness in the past. But there are some things, there are lights that have carried on through the generations since the coming of Christ that have informed us, that have shaped us, and that we see evident in Harry's life, certainly in the stories that we've heard today. By the way, I just love that you pointed out what it says on a KFC box. That's the best. There are certain values. In fact, there are a couple of virtues that have long been held for leaders, and Harry was a leader. Gravitas. Gravitas, that sense of importance of the task, taking things with earnest responsibility. Severitas, which means seriousness or self-control, allowing ourselves to have fun but not letting ourselves to get so carried away that we harm others. Veritas, which is about truthfulness, honesty in dealing with others, with our family, with our community, and in business. Vitris, which is about courage. Courage not just to do things that are reckless or scary, but courage to do what's right for society, what's right for community. Courage when it comes to making decisions. And fides, or faith. That is about trusting in the unseen, trusting in the presence and the goodness of God, who is at the center of the universe and who calls us to live a life in honor of him. Harry was old school. He was old school in many ways. I'm sure you know that he loved ice cream. They made it at Christmas. How many of you grew up in a home that you made ice cream at Christmas? Oh, yeah. That's a maritime thing. I grew up Prince Edward Island, Anne of Green Gables, made ice cream every Christmas. And Harry was into the old school flavors, grape nut. Oh, don't choke. Orange pineapple. My personal favorite, I don't know if Harry liked it, rum raisin, but you know. He was a man of gravitas, self-control, truthfulness, courage, and certainly of faith. And he passed those virtues on to his children and his grandchildren, and that is evidently abundant today as we've been hearing their stories. How did he do that? How did he pass that on to this generation that is here today celebrating his life? Certainly by his example. For he and Pauline, they sought to raise a family that took life and faith and character seriously and still had fun and didn't take themselves too seriously. For he was always singing, two scoops of ice cream, not one. Don't insult him with one. Christmas fudge, playing games, lots of laughter. The words of the psalmist tell us about our identity. Don't forget who you are. Psalm 16 says, I say to the Lord, you are my Lord, and I have no good apart from you. Our identity is founded, it's based in the fact that each of us were created in the image of the Creator, in the image of God. All good things in life, all good things are gifts that come from God from above. It doesn't matter where we are in the world, what ethnicity or gender or culture or even religion, all good things come from God. Every good thing we have in life and that we treasure and we hold on to is a glimpse of the God who made us. And those good things we see in one another, those are God's presence moving within us. But of course, God is calling us to grow, not to stay the same, but to continue to grow into his goodness, into the fullness of life that is made apparent, visible in Jesus Christ. Psalm 139, which Pastor Erica read today, tells us of this story. It begins, O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. God knows each one of us. He knows our names. He knows that we're not here to celebrate Ramona. But if your name is Ramona, he knows you too. God knows Harry. God knows each one of us. And I love that beautiful image that we have here in Psalm 139, that before we took our first breath, God was knitting us together in our mother's womb. God was knitting us together. This God, this creator God, is a poet. He's a musician. This God, this creator God, is a maker of all good things. And he was knitting you together in your mother's womb as he was knitting Harry together before he took his first breath. The psalmist goes on, "For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb, and I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made, And wonderful are the works of you, O God. I know that full well. For my frame was not hidden from you when I was made in that secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. God, our Father, loves us and knows us, each one of us, daughters and sons. How precious you are to me, O God. How precious are your thoughts. They are vast, and I cannot number them. And God will not forget you. The psalmist reminds us that God's knowledge of us is not temporary, but it is eternal. And God's desire is that not only would he know us, but we would know him, and that our knowledge and our relationship with God would change everything. The gospel, the good news we celebrate in a church like this, is of transformation, that God wants us to experience a relationship with him, the one that Harry had, that changed and transformed the way that Harry related to the world, to the planet, to the rivers, to the streams, to the forest, and to the people on it. God calls us to experience that life that Jesus calls abundant life, life as it was meant to be, eternal life. And the life that Harry experienced in God bore fruit. Fruit is the consequence of faith, not a prerequisition for it. Character comes about because of the seed of faith planted in our lives, allowed to grow and to bloom and to change us from the inside out. And so we have this simple Latin phrase, one that Harry said in English very often to his kids. In fact, I'm told as they were growing up as teenagers, before they went out to do whatever teenagers do, when they go out, Harry would say to them, remember who you are. Remember who you are. What a thing for a father to say to their kids. You are my daughter. You are our daughter. You are my son. You are our son. And you are a child of God. You are a beloved child of God. And of course, this is what we remember today as we celebrate Harry's life. That Harry is a child of God. The psalmists tell us of God's knowledge of us, but the prophet Isaiah shares a profound and powerful truth, that even when we don't remember, even when we forget, God does not forget us. I imagine many of you have been with Pauline and Harry over these last years, over this last decade. And sometimes as we go through the later years of our life, we experience the struggles of the body that was once so strong and vigorous starting to fail. And for some of us, our memories fail. I visited Harry many times at Ryan Hall, but I don't think he ever knew who I was. How could he? I was a new face in a sea of unfamiliar faces. But he was always kind, and he was always generous, and he never tried to sell me anything, which is amazing. I think he asked me for ice cream once, but just once. God remembers us, even if we don't remember him. Isaiah tells us that could a mother forget her child? But even if a mother was to forget her child, God will not forget you, for he has written your name on the palms of his hand. In that moment when Harry took his last breath in this world, it was those open hands of God there to embrace him and to draw him to himself, to look into his eyes and say, son, my beloved Harry, well done. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks that you are a good God and that there is nothing in all of creation, no depth, no height, no darkness that can ever separate us from your love. God, we thank you that you're a God who calls us children, your children, and you want us to know you as Father. And we thank you that Jesus came into the world to show us the depth of your love, to demonstrate it, that while we were yet lost, while we were sinners, while we were in darkness, you would even die for us. Lord, I thank you for your love, a love not just in words, but a love in action and in deed. May that love, Lord, be a strength for us today, and it may be a North Star to lead us as we continue to journey through life, to journey towards you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite Pastor Erica to come at this time, and she's going to share a prayer blessing for the family. And before we end the service, the choir is going to be coming and sharing a piece of special music.
Let's pray together. Almighty and ever-living God, we come to you, for you invite us into a relationship of trust. You wait for us in moments like these. We come to you through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have come to know you as our good Father. We come to you by the comforting presence of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit present and among us today, the Spirit who fills our lungs with the breath of life and our hearts with hope. We come to pray for the family of our friend Harry Delong, beloved by so many and missed now so keenly. We pray especially for Pauline and their children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. You know each one. You know who they are, and you know where they are. You know them completely. You know us better than we know ourselves, for you have made us for yourself, and we are restless until we find our rest in you. Enter their sorrow, Lord, like you would walk into and through a deep, dark canyon and linger among them, so that when they have a flash flood of tears, let those moments of grief expose long forgotten strata of life laid down in the peaceful decades, so that they might examine the rough earth of lament for things said and things left unsaid. May their weeping wash the wounds clean. May the wind of your Holy Spirit move through that valley and bring healing and new life, which always takes time, more time than we think. Meander with them, Lord, in such a way as to lead them, hold them up, and carry their burden from time to time. Remind them of their lost loved ones. Sorrow with them and rejoice with them in their memories. Remind them of where you were in each memory. Remind them that you are right here as they grieve. Remind us of your eternal truths, that you are our eternal refuge, and underneath are your everlasting arms. Let them feel how you have been present in the very depths of their feelings so that they would find you already there. Remind them of this ancient psalm you inspired so long ago. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations, before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world from everlasting to everlasting. You are God. Amen. And now let's pray together in the words that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
hear Harry and Pauline singing the duet. That was amazing. We're going to come to an end now after the word of benediction. The family are going to be making their way out for the reception in the gymnasium. We're not having a receiving line. We're going to invite the family to go first and to spread out, get a tea or a coffee or get something to eat, and then for the rest of us to follow in. And please do the same. Get yourself some refreshments and then make your way around, share stories with one another, and find the family as they'll be spread out through the gymnasium. Thank you so much for coming and being a part of this service honoring Harry's life and faith. A big thanks on behalf of the family to all those who've come, for those who have prepared the meal. We appreciate all the women who are already, I think, in the kitchen getting ready for us. The coffee's on. A big thanks to Debbie Zwicker and the choir as well for honoring Harry today. And now may we go forth in the love of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and in the presence and peace of the Holy Spirit. May he dwell within and through you now and forevermore. Amen.